At ESMO 2020 virtual meeting, again, we have seen interesting data about melanoma. So we have seen interesting data from the COMBI. The COMBI was a randomized phase 3 trial, which compared the triplet with dabrafenib, trametinib, espartalizumab to dabrafenib alone. You have seen the first report of a sequential study, the SEQOMBIT study. You have seen an update about the distant metastasis-free survival from the ORTC study, the KEYNOTE-054, which compared pembrolizumab to placebo. And we have seen other interesting data from a new combination of pembrolizumab and lenvatinib in patients who previously failed anti-PD-1. There was a lot of expectation for seeing the data of the COMBI, the part 3 COMBI, the randomized phase 3 trial, which compared the triplet with dabrafenib, trametinib, spartalizumab to dabrafenib, trametinib, and placebo. This study enrolled 532 patients. All the patients were BRAF mutated. All the patients were naive and with a performance status from 0 to 2. The main endpoint of the study was the progression-free survival. The final analysis that we are reporting here, that I'm commented here, was with a minimum follow-up of 24 months from the last patients randomized, and the statistical threshold was 0.02497. This is important in order to better understand the data. Looking to the PFS, the data unfortunately showed that the trial did not meet the primary endpoint. The median was in the triplet 16 months, about 16 months, while in the comparator arm 12 months. The hazard ratio was 0.82, but not significant, because we should remember that the statistical threshold was 0.02497. About the rate, the PFS rate to here, this was 44% in the triplet arm, while was 36% in the comparator arm. The response rate was similar between the two groups, 68% in the triplet, 64% in the comparator arm, with a little bit more complete response in the triplet, about 20% compared to 18% from dabrafenib and placebo. Of course, more durable response were in the triplet arm, as also we have seen the previous clinical trial. About the overall survival, the two curves seem similar. At 2 years, looking to the OS rate, this was of 68% in the triplet and 62% in the comparator arm. Probably we need a longer follow-up in order to see if there is if there are some difference, even because more patients in the comparator arm were treated with immunotherapy checkpoint inhibitor than in the triplet arm. Safety is also important for the triplet, because we have seen the previous report that there was an increase of side effect. And here, if we look the percentage of adverse event will lead to discontinuation, interruption, or adjustment of study drugs, this was 49%. That is high. So in conclusion, what I can say, the study was negative, but looking to the PFS curves, this looks similar to the PFS curves that we have seen in KEYNOTE-022 and INSPIRE-150 from the other triplet. So I believe that we need a longer follow-up. The negative of the study probably is due to the statistical design. And with a longer follow-up, probably we will have additional information that can give us more and further insight about the possible role of this treatment for the metastatic melanoma patients. There was an additional expectation for the SEQOMBIT study. You know, the SEQOMBIT study was the first study reported in a meeting about the sequence between target therapy and immunotherapy. The SEQOMBIT was a randomized phase 2 trial, 3 arms, with no formal comparative test. We enrolled 209 patients in different 3 arms, and were enrolled 69 in arm A, 71 in arm B, and 69 in arm C. Looking to the different treatment in arm A, the sequence was encorafenib, binimetinib, in case of progression, nipirion, nivolumab, In arm B, i prioni volume is first, and then a progression and chorafin and binimetrin, and then arm C, the so-called sandwich. Why sandwich? Because immunotherapy was put in the middle of two different courses of target therapy. The first in 8 weeks with encorafenib and binimetrin, the switch at response and not at progression. And then in case of progression to ipinivo, again encorafenib and binimetrin. The median follow-up was 17.5 months, and we reported the data, the first data in terms of response rate, PFS, duration of response, and safety, and even preliminary data about the total progression-free survival. So looking to the response rate, PFS, and all the other data, these are consistent with all the data about the same parameters that we have seen in previous studies with encorafenib, binimetrin, ipilimumab, and nivolumab. Even the safety, no new signal of new adverse event, no treatment-related death, just a little bit more of fever in the arm C, the sandwich, probably at the switch from target therapy to immunotherapy. About the PFS, the two-year PFS was similar, 35% in arm A, a little bit more in arm B and C, 38-39% respectively. Interesting is the total progression-free survival. Why interesting? Because this is a surrogate of overall survival. Overall survival is the main endpoint of the study. It's immature, a very limited number of patients, but interesting. Why interesting? Because at 24 months, in arm A was of 48%, in arm B, 58%, in arm C, 62%, with an interesting trend of the tail. Of course, this makes these results interesting, but at the moment, very immature. So we need a longer follow-up in order to confirm this data. And next year, at ESMO 2021, we will probably report the first data of overall survival that, as I told you, is the main endpoint. Another interesting report at ESMO this year was the update of the ORTC trial, the KEYNOTE-054. The KEYNOTE-054 was a phase 3 randomized trial in the adjuvant setting of the patients with stage 3 according to the 7th edition of the JCC classification. And the study enrolled 1,019 patients in the two different arms, one arm with the pembrolizumab given a dosage of 200 milligrams every 3 weeks compared to the placebo arm. This study was already reported some years ago, and this is an update with the data at 4 years of the distant metastasis-free survival. Looking to this data, these data look really interesting because confirm the superiority of the group of patients treated with pembrolizumab to the placebo group. The hazard ratio was 0.6, that means the 40% of risk reduction for the distant metastasis. And looking to the distant metastasis-free survival at 4 years, this was 65.3% in the experimental arm with pembrolizumab, 49.4% in the placebo arm. It is really interesting. And this was in all the subgroup of patients, the patients with PD-L1 positive or negative, the patients BRAF mutated or wild type, the patients with the different stage 3, the stage 3 A, B, and C, the same impact. Pembrolizumab are still better compared to the placebo. Looking to the updated of the relapse-free survival, the first disclosure of this data was ACR 3 years ago, and then last year at ASCO, the 3 years data, at 4 years now, at about 4 years, because at the moment the follow-up was 3.5 years, the hazard ratio is still interesting, 0.59, 31% of risk reduction, 41% of risk reduction for relapse, and the 3.5 years relapse-free survival are 59.8% compared to the 41.4% of control arm. So there was a confirmation of the superiority of pembrolizumab given as adjuvant, even the safety, no new signal compared to that reported in the previous experience, and pembrolizumab confirmed to be an important option for the patients in the treatment of as adjuvant. We'll see in the next year the final data with overall survival. Interesting data come from a new combination, pembrolizumab and lenvatinib. At ESMO, it was reported the data of the phase 2 trial that is an open-label open label single arm with this combination, pembrolizumab, classical dosage, and lenvatinib to 20 milligrams per square diem. The study enrolled 103 patients. The main endpoint of study was the response rate. The response rate in the intent-to-treat population was 21.4%. This is still interesting. But more interesting is the response rate in the 29 patients that received previously the combination of anti-CTLA-4 and anti-PD-1. In this group of patients, the response rate was 31%. That looks really interesting for patients who were refractory resistant to anti-PD-1, anti-CTLA-4. The safety, it's interesting. You know, with the combination, we have always an increase of toxicity. And looking to the grade 3 and 5 adverse event, the percentage was 44.7%. But the percentage of patients who discontinued treatment for toxicity was 7.8%. This is good. It's not so high. The majority of toxicity were hypertension, that is due to the lenvatinib, and diarrhea due to pembrolizumab. And it looks very safe, this combination, even with an important 31% of response in the patients who failed the combination of anti-CTLA-4. So I believe that this combination deserves to go in a randomized phase 3 trial. In the future, I'm sure that we will see data from this kind of trial.